Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum, dears. Let's discuss some of the major themes in the play The Three Penny Opera by Bertolt Brecht. The first theme of the play is greed, selfishness and corruption. The whole play represents greedy, corrupt characters, men and women who steal, cheat and bribe their way through the world. Brecht has introduced many characters and even all the characters in the play who are greedy in their own ways. And he refrains from casting judgment on these characters. He just wants to show how a society which is built on greed, selfishness and corruption easily forces its people to become similarly greedy, selfish and corrupt in order to get by and to survive in the same society. Throughout the play, Brecht uses a cast of characters who are corrupt in both practices and morals to outline the different ways in which the capitalist society run by greedy, selfish individuals breeds a new crop of greedy, selfish individuals from the bottom up. Brecht shows an immoral society where the individuals are forced to choose illegal ways for their survival. For example, the beggar's friend, Peachum, who is the example of dishonesty and greed in the play. He does all these things for his survival. The establishment is a place where he distributes different clothes, cardboard signs and other false stamps to the beggars, and he also issues licenses to these beggars. In a way, he is the chief of all the beggars in London. He has controlled almost all the beggars in London and he is very much gleeful about his total financial control of London. He collects a percentage from every beggar he licenses, and moreover, he is the one who selects signs, Bible verses and other most misery statements for the beggars in order to make them beg in the most easiest and convincing manner. Brecht, the writer of the play, has shown how Peachum is the product of this environment. The environment that is overburdened with selfishness, greed and corruption. With poverty and dissatisfaction of the law inside London, it makes sense that the only way for the people to survive is to find a way to profit off the suffering of others. Peachum knows the kind of world he lives in. In Act 3, he says, "Sleepless nights working out how to extract a pence from poverty." He has realized that the rich are weaklings and fools. Peachum has nothing but contempt for the rich, but also knows that they have nothing but contempt for the likes of him. Therefore, he has come up with a way to provide for his family and profit off the status quo. On the other hand, Makieth and his gang members present another example of the individuals living in a corrupt society and the corrupt mean they use to get benefits from the society. These gang members steal and kill and commit arson and larceny and generally creates disturbance in the whole society. But Brecht often appears to celebrate their gains throughout the opera, showing how Makieth and his thugs have found a way to gain not only material success, but the fear and thus respect of their community. Makieth and his gang have found a way to profit off a society's fixation on the upcoming coronation of the queen, committing crimes while the masses are distracted. They all know that their society is unfair and unjust, and thus they produce in response the same unfair and unjust means for getting money. Makieth is an army man who has seen all the corruption from the inside. He knows how a royal army recruits good people to send for their deaths, how police turn a blind eye taking bribe, how the rich ignore the plight of the poor. Thus he knows that the only way to make something of himself is to become a major player in the London's underworld. Amazing a reputation built not on the bourgeois arbitrary markings of success, but instead on the hard-won respect and fear of others like him. Another way Makieth and his gang turn to corruption with an already corrupt society is by making bargains with the cops of London. And we see that Tiger Brown and Constable Smith, they are very eager to take bribe from these thugs and killers. And this is how Brecht has represented the whole society. It means that injustice prevails, imbalance prevails in the whole society. Not only the gangsters, but the police, the law, the establishment, the common people, the business tycoons, all are corrupt, greedy, and selfish. One of the artistic quality of Brecht is that he does not pass any judgment upon these characters. He just wants to show how a society which is corrupt breeds individual like the characters he has presented. The three-penny opera is a scathing social critique of societies and governments which stick by immorality, never stopping to consider the wider, deeper effects of institutional corruption. As Brecht parades a set of characters of loose moral values and behavior before the audience in this play. The next theme is love and sex. In the three-penny opera, the slick, cunning, and magnetic gangster, Macbeth, has recently married Polly, who is the only daughter of Peachum's family. He has also relations with Jenny, the prostitute. In addition to this, he has also relations with other prostitutes as well as the daughter of Tiger Brown, Lucy. Because of Polly's marriage, Mr. Peachum devises a plan to send Macbeth to jail once and for all, but he fails. Macbeth, who cannot escape of this leisure life, goes to the brothel and he is trapped by the police, bribed by Peachum. By illustrating Macbeth's insatiable and awful ill-advised lust contrasted against the suffering of his jilted lovers Polly, Lucy, and Jenny. He misses opportunity after opportunity to get out of London and hide out in the country. Because of his nature to pay series of visits to different mistresses and prostitutes in brothels. And this way Brecht argues that love and sex are destructive forces which render men and women alike incapable of making sound smart choices. These destructive forces deviate people from their objectives, from their aims, and thus they become victims of the forces of capitalism and corruption. There are different farces, six farces in this play. A bedroom farce is a kind of comedy that focuses on multiple iterations of romantic and sexual pairings throughout a bumbling cast of characters. Macbeth exploits, albeit humorous for the audience, show how lust and love creates diversions and conflicts which distract men and women alike from the real enemy, corrupt capitalism. Macbeth, the central character of the play, could avoid the raid of the police if he chose not to come to the brothel. But Macbeth is repeatedly drawn into whorehouses and thus he is caught by police in the brothel in the very first act. The theme of love and sex is again focused here because he was caught with the help of Jenny, who is a prostitute and who is the past lover of Mr. Macbeth. Macbeth wants to shelter in a country after his wedding when he was informed by Polly their father has made a plan to arrest him, but his sexual desires made him stay in London and thus he was easily chased by police and Mr. Peachum. And thus, this way Brecht shows how love and lust distract from survival in dangerously corrupt world. Because Macbeth was unable to survive and protect himself from the police and jail due to these lusty desires. We also see that in jail where he meets his two wives, Lucy and Polly, and then when he becomes able to run away from the jail, he again goes to another prostitute, Sakhi Tawdry, another former lover. And again, he is caught by the police because of this visit to a prostitute. Thus, he is the victim of sexual submissiveness. And this distracts him from saving himself from the police and Beecham's family. Throughout the play, Brecht shows how love and lust make people fool. Although this argument is not the most radical argument, instead Brecht wants to highlight that in a corrupt and greedy society, lust and love are distractions and indeed liabilities meant to keep the improvised working class from focusing on what truly matters. And this is so clever because the people who are busy in these love affairs, lust and sexual abuses, they are unable to focus on the real enemies in their society, on the real corruption in their society, on the issues of capitalism in this society. They become the victim of economy and many other things. The next major theme in this play is the ravage of capitalism. Brecht has shown the ravages of capitalism. He has shown how people from all walks of life become beggars and how they adopt and purchase different costumes from the beggar's friend Beecham to become beggars and how they collect money from people in the streets of London. Although no real poor has been shown on stage from the play, and all this beggary shown in the play is a game played by the corrupt social members of the society. Brecht, who is very much anti-capitalist, has used this play to show how capitalism has ravaged societies. He is also of the view that until a new economic system takes its place, all human life is doomed to be a veil of tribulation, marked by sorrow, corruption and coldness, not just in society, but in the very soul. Throughout the play, Brecht has presented many scenes, songs and lines that further asserts how capitalist and how capitalism is futile and hopeless for all human endeavors. The two songs in particular, taken from Act 3, The Height of the Play, Commotion, stands out as the most powerful message by Brecht against cruelty and banality of capitalism, the song of futility of all human endeavor, sung somewhat trumpetly by Beecham at the start of Act 3. This is such an interesting song that presents very deep message regarding capitalism and the greed and selfishness in the society. This song also presents the ills of capitalism in the society, how capitalism is dangerous for the people living in a society. Brecht's character in the play, they are suffering under capitalism, but they are unable to pull out themselves from this despair. And they are also unable to create a new, better world. There is no justice in the society. There is no fair play. There is no fair work. And it is all because of capitalism. This is what Brecht has argued in this play. Another song that is sung by Jenny in this play also presents Brecht's own commentary on the ways in which capitalism has ravaged not just the society, the organizational pattern of the society, but the people living inside the society, which shows how Brecht himself has struggled against capitalism and which shows how capitalism is beneficial for the rich people and it is very dangerous for the lower class. Theater Archetypes, another theme. During his lifetime, Brecht becomes well known as one of the foremost practitioners of epic theater, a theatrical form in which the audience is constantly reminded of their role as spectators and in which the play or opera makes frequent notes to its own dramatic structure. Throughout the play, Brecht deepens the self-referential aesthetic of epic theater by employing the use of character archetypes which aid to the moralistic, cheeky plot. Through the twinned use of archetypes and artifice in this instance representing the contrived nature of opera's plot and the ways in which the work repeatedly recognizes itself as a construct, Brecht argues that theater should not be an institution of art for the bourgeois. It should be for the general public, for the general understanding of the society. And thus he is of the view that the general public and the common people should be actors in this kind of theater. All of Brecht's theatrical work involves some measure of artifice, revealing the mechanics of theatrics. After all, is one of the epic theater moment. He has also presented some archetypes, some representation of class. For example, the gangster, Macbeth, the whore Jenny, the beggar Beecham, and the corrupt policeman Tiger Brown. Thus he shows the whole society which is corrupted in the time when the play is written. By creating an opera, which is a high art form, he has also shown that theater is not only for the privileged class, it is for the lower class, for the common masses of the society. In order to more clarify this argument, he created a play about the underworld of London. The beggars, the thieves are there, the prostitutes are there, and these are the common general public of the society. Some of the characters are the archetypes. They are even stereotypes, and they roam around in the streets of London just like the common people. So this play is not only for the bourgeois, educated bourgeois, but also for the lower class people, for all the people living in the society. The moon, which is a symbol in this play, because of the nature of epic theater and its straightforward fourth wall demolishing stark method of storytelling, there aren't a lot of symbols in the three-penny opera. One recurring image that does, however, serve as a kind of symbolic purpose is that of the moon. Throughout the opera, several characters notice the brightness of the moon over their London's neighborhood of Soho, and the effect the moonlight has on the people's behavior. For example, Peacham's family. Peacham's family thought that moon has affected their daughter, and it is the moon that has influenced their daughter to be attracted towards the Macheath, the thief. Later on in the play, Polly also realized, and when she went to jail to meet Macheath, she says that I saw a moon in the dream, which was quite thin and like a penny, all worn away. Thus, the moon emerges as a symbol of frivolity, of romance and infatuation, and the changeable nature of love, sex and lust, which is the major theme of the play. Thus, the only symbol that is in this play is the moon. This was about the major themes of the play. Thanks for watching.